Surendran, hi, good to have you with us. How have you been?
Super awesome, Ashu. Thank you for having me here on this platform.
You know, this is an exciting conversation. I think with all the good work that you've been doing at SuccessGyan, right? I mean, I've been an avid follower, right? You know, and some of the people who've been speaking on the platform, I've had the opportunity of knowing those people up close and personal, right? And I think one thing that I can tell you is that in the complex world that we are in, right? And I think it's just so much more important to have right kind of people, leaders around you, right? Who can help you simplify this entire, you know, complexity, right? The quagmire that we operate in, right? The way I'd like to classically put it, right? And it does, it becomes very important, right? And I think SuccessGyan is essentially trying to solve that, right? Where you're trying to make, people who understood this space beautifully, right? Who become mentors in many, many ways, right? To help them help many others, right? A business model with that narrative, it can't get more beautiful than that, right? So I think that's great work that you are at. And this becomes an exciting conversation in that context, right? Especially around COVID times, which has been extremely complicated, right? It's been difficult at a personal level and a professional level. It just becomes so much more interesting, right? So I am particularly looking forward to this conversation. And as we dive into this conversation, I'd love to start this conversation with a quick round of introduction, right? You've been there, I'd love to understand, what are some of the things that you've done in your professional career and a little more about SuccessGyan.
Thank you so much. And it's a totally honor and privilege to be in this platform. And as you rightly said, COVID, post-COVID, more than ever, this education has become very vital for every single human being on this planet. Because COVID has completely disrupted the education system. No matter who you are, COVID has taken you out of the game. So that's where we come in. We are actually a platform where we bring the world's best trainers and give it to our consumers. That's what we actually do. We are the world's largest platform in terms of bringing trainers and curating content for our consumers. Just to give you a background, we started in 2012 and we had three guiding principles when we started. We wanted to bring the world's best education at affordable prices to every Indian. Mm-hmm. We wanted to make India a land of job creators.
Right.
And we wanted to bring world's best to India and take India's best to the world. These were our three guiding principles. And that's why we started. And to retrace the background, why did we start? My life changed because of personal development.
Right.
I've gone through three business failures in my worst low. Brian Tracy had come to Chennai for a one-day seminar.
Right.
One of my friends pushed me to that seminar. Something Brian Tracy said changed my life.
Interesting.
That night, I couldn't sleep. And that night, I made myself a promise. Right. Once I make a lot of money, I'm going to bring Brian Tracy to Chennai and do a seminar for my friends and family. So that was the promise I made myself. Right. I implemented what Brian said. My business started growing. It started growing really well. Then I started looking for such more trainings.
Right.
That time in India, no trainers used to come to India. So I went to Singapore, learned from Tony Robbins. Right. I went to Malaysia, learned from Harv Eker. I understood a very simple formula. The more I invested in my re-education, the faster I started growing.
Right.
And I started building multiple businesses. Life went really well. 2011, November, I went back to my dream. Now that I've made lots of money, multiple business, let me go back to the promise I made myself.
Right.
Let me bring Brian Tracy to India. So SuccessGyan was actually started to bring Brian Tracy to India and do a seminar for my friends and family.
Interesting.
Feb 2012, we did the first seminar with Brian Tracy. 400 of my friends and family came in. They got completely blown. That's how SuccessGyan actually started.
Interesting. That's a brilliant and a beautiful journey, right? And I think, it's heartening to hear all of this, right? From what you'd experienced, right, to kind of, for that cause to becoming a mission, right? And I think trying to sort of impact the lives of so many others, right? It's beautiful, right? It's amazing. And I hope that, many people who are going to listen to this conversation get inspired to essentially contribute to many others, right, who are out there. Because I think that's an ecosystem that we require. I think that's a very, very critical piece, right? For I think for any country, right, any nation that wants to sort of get to a point of being developed, I think it requires a very strong community, right, to come together where one helps the other, right? I'm going to move into the serious aspects of our discussion right today, and I'm going to start this by this fact, which is around, say, personality development, motivation, right? And that's denial. Right. As soon as you start, talking of, say, help, assistance, mentoring, right? India is a market for some reason, where we start to deny, saying that, listen, we know it all, right? And that's not a great phase, right? I mean, and as soon as you start looking at, markets abroad, right? There's a very different kind of maturity, right? People understand what this is, right? People understand that they require it, right? They understand many other nuances around it, right? What's your sense of it, right? I mean, you are trying to sort of you've been working at it, you've been trying to sort of crack it for a market, which, like I said, right, operates in denial, right? What's your sense of it?
Thank you, Ashu. It's a brilliant question for a simple reason, what you rightly said. I just want to tell the facts. There's a difference between schooling and education. Let's understand that first. There's a big difference. Most people confuse schooling with education.
Right.
What is schooling? Your school and college helps you get a job. Right. That's it. Just let's get that right. Anything you want, you ask a common man what he wants in life. He'll say, I want to make money. Mm-hmm. I want to handle failures. I want to take care of rejections. I want to know how to manage money. You can ask any common man. He'll give you 100 answers.
Right.
None of the 100 things are taught in schools.
Mm-hmm.
Very vital question for us to understand.
Right.
Correct? So this is where personal development comes into place.
Mm-hmm.
Education actually starts after schooling. This is what I believe in.
Right.
And these are skills you need to live in today's world. How to handle money is a skill nobody teaches you. Money is a taboo topic. Like while you're growing, somebody said rich people are arrogant or money doesn't go on tea. It's a conditioning in your head. You will never make money because you don't want to be arrogant.
Right.
Correct? So these are things which have, so this is where personal development comes into play. And as you rightly said, 2012, when we started, nobody understood this education.
Mm-hmm.
It was really tough.
Right.
I used to bring Brian Tracy, Jack Canfield, the best of the best teachers to India and run workshops and seminars. Few hundred people used to come. And I always felt, why? But then I realized that people didn't understand the value of this education. Until they taste it, they won't know. And 2014 is when we flipped it. We did something called National Achievers Conference.
Right.
We bought Robert Kiyosaki and Les Brown. And I told my team, the problem is people don't know the value of it.
Right.
Why can't we flip it where we give them so much value at extremely crazy cost?
Right.
So we bought Robert Kiyosaki and we bought Les Brown and 10 other trainers, did this program called National Achievers Conference in Delhi and Bangalore. We charged 1,000 rupees for a 2-day event where the food cost alone would be at least 7,000, 8,000. People knew that.
Right.
So 2,000 plus people came in Bangalore and Delhi. They loved it. Mm-hmm. And from there, we started selling the future courses. So we flipped the model in 2014. And from there, there were no looking back. In 2019, before COVID, we were doing 150 plus seminars across 13 cities in India. More than 50,000 people have come into our trainings.
Wow.
In 2019 alone. So then people, once people taste it, they know that the best investment they need to do is in themselves. The more they invest in themselves, faster they can grow. So that's as simple as that.
Very interesting. You know, I'm actually intrigued, right? And I would love to know a little more about the construct, right? Now, is this essentially, essentially a seminar-based or an interaction-based engagement, right? From where on people now need to sort of kind of define their, own paths. Or is this something which is longer than that, right? So there's a formal structure to it. I mean, tell me a little more about the construct, right? And what I also want to understand is what are the key focus areas, right? So is personality development the only, for example, say focus area? Or there are many, many subsets to it, right? You break it down and systematically saying that, you could require A, B, C, D, right? I mean, I want to understand a little more about the that offering, right? Which SuccessGAN has to make to the people out there.
Thank you, Ashu. Till 2019, we were a seminar model where we used to run physical programs across the country. 13 cities.
Right.
When we started 2012, we were telling what is the core audience?
Uh-huh.
What is the problem we want to solve? So my core audience, which I took that time, was small and medium business owners and entrepreneurs and startups.
Right.
For a simple reason, I truly believe the backbone of a country is the small and medium business owners. Because these are the people who pay taxes on time, who give maximum employment, but they don't take money back home.
Right.
Which is a critical thing. And they have no clue because most people started with a passion and a vision. And they can't even go back and tell their wife that I can't change now because that's their passion. And so they stuck both ways. And for them, the dream is every first they have to pay salary. That's what is their dream.
Right.
So for me, I said, let me go solve the problem. Can I give trainings to people like this who are actually backbone for this country? So that's the first set of programs we started in 2012, where we focused on small and medium business owners and entrepreneurs.
Mm-hmm.
And as you rightly said, our methodology, all are live programs where we teach you this, we inspire you. We educate you, we empower you. We do all three things.
Right.
Because motivation is something which I'm not very, very keen of.
Because
motivation, what does motivation mean? Somebody is telling you to do something which you're supposed to do. That is motivation.
Right.
So if you're a business owner, if somebody has to inspire you to do something, then something is really wrong with what you're doing. Correct? Why should somebody externally tell you? So I'm not a big fan of motivation. I'm a big fan of inspiration.
Right.
Where I light the spark and I teach you what to do. And from then on, you don't need me. You can do it. So that's the angle we went in. So we teach all the skill sets. We teach all the technique. And we also get the best of the best practices, and we do it in a live program format where the business owner comes to the room and he learns the science of building business. Mm-hmm. And he starts implementing and he sees a difference. So that's our methodology. We are live, we are on, we are interactive, and the methodology we use is something which nobody else does in schools. Because normally if you go to school, you can't work with people. Collaborative teaching is not done, correct?
Right.
Copying is long in school. But here we've set in such a way that you work with people around you, plus you also get the skills, and you do it in such a way that you can implement then and there. Because our trainings work at a DNA level. You don't need to take down notes. You get it and it goes at a DNA level. It's like a song. You like a song. After 20 years, you can recall the song, right? Why?
Right.
Because it's in your DNA level. Same thing. Right. That's how we do. We call something called accelerated training. There's a lot of engagement. And people learn on the go, and concepts go deep dive in your DNA. And that's the technology we use.
Awesome. You know, I'd love to know about one. So give me an example. You know, I mean, what would be the case in point, right? I'd love to understand, construct of, say, one engagement, right? I mean, if you could take me through, a learner's journey, that'd be interesting, right? So, you know, how long are these training sessions, right? What are some of the, so for example, say, if I'm an SME, MSME owner, right? I want to improve, for example, my business, right? Possibilities around my business, you know, permutation combinations, right? How do I manage my finances? How do I manage growth? How do I say leadership, right? Which is again very, very critical, right? What is the construct of a program, right? How long are these trainings, right? What kind of exercises do I have to go through? Tell me a little more about that.
Awesome. So till 2019, our focus here was small and business owners. Then COVID happened, and COVID we went online. Everything we do is completely online. And you can sit at the comfort of the home. You're going to bring this education to your home. Okay, now to answer your question. We work with Rajiv Talreja, who's India's leading business coach. In fact, he's Asia's leading business coach. Mm-hmm. We have customers from Malaysia, Philippines, Vietnam coming to our rooms. Right. Now, he's the author of a book called Lead or Bleed. It's an international bestseller.
Right.
Now, we work exclusive with him. Now, what's the training methodology? You might see, we have a four-hour program called Business Breakthrough Seminar. Mm-hmm. Which is priced at 99 rupees.
Okay.
That's it. I don't want to give free, because if I give free, people don't value it. That's why I priced at 99. So pay and come. That's the idea. In 4 hours, Raji will deep dive and kind of dissect your whole business journey.
Right.
End of 4 hours, you know where your problem is. Mm-hmm. What is that you have to fix? And from there, we do our main program, which is called a business-based program, which is a live interactive 3-day session. It starts at 9 a.m., goes to 7 p.m. It's 3 days. So people come to the 3-day program. That is where they actually learn the science of it.
Right.
Every business has got 7 functions, just to break it down. Okay. Mm-hmm. You have sales, marketing, accounts, and operations, so on. Correct?
Right.
Normally a problem with a small and medium business owners, he's doing one or more of the function.
Mm-hmm.
When he's selling, he's not able to deliver. When he's deliver, he's not selling. That's the problem. So we teach people three vital things. You need to build your team.
Mm-hmm.
You need to have strategies.
Right.
And these are things you need to do. And you need to know best practice to do right now. So this 3-day program kind of dissects and tells how you can actually understand the 7 areas of your business, how you can build a team, how you can strategize, and how you can get started.
Mm-hmm.
And from then on, if they want a hand-holding coaching, we do that also. So this is more of a knowledge-based training where the business owner is empowered on what he needs to do to fix his current business.
Mm-hmm.
And this is done after a lot of study. And to answer your question, I have thousands and thousands of business owners from all verticals who come to a room. I have a guy who runs a manufacturing company. I have a service industry guy. I have a doctor who's got a hospital. So all kinds of people.
Right.
And the results we have produced is phenomenal because of our training methodology. It's live. We teach you the skill because we do not want to be a consultant where you pay me 2 lakhs, 3 lakhs and every month I do something for you and you have no clue how I'm fixing it.
No. Right.
We want to empower the business owner where we want him to learn so that from then on he can take forward so that he can scale faster. The tagline of the program is how you can build a business which can grow without you. That's what you want to teach.
You know, Sundar, listen, I'm you kind of walked me into my next question, right? And this is something, this is a question that I have to ask across all of my conversations, right? I think every business owner, professional, everybody, right, who's the business ecosystem, this is a question, it's become almost a constant, right, across each conversation. Now, what is happening is, I mean, as soon as you start talking, say, India, and I'm going to touch upon Southeast Asia just a bit, or Asia in just a bit, right? But when you talk of India, which is a huge opportunity, right? When you talk about SMEs, MSMEs, right? You talk about roughly 47 million businesses that qualify within the government prescribed, norms, right? That's a massive number, right? Many countries don't enjoy that kind of, number of citizens, right? And let alone businesses, right? We're a large ship, right? But we're also a very complex ship, right? We're a complicated ship, right? We operate at many, many layers, right? There are different kind of priorities, right? There is a huge regionality play which comes into the big, right? Motivations are very different. Inspirations are very different. The way you live is very different, right? There is just so much there's just so much nuances to the existence of an individual, right? Which affects him or her at a personal level. And of course, like I said, business priorities completely are defined and are essentially in line with that, right? What happens in an environment like that, right? I mean, how difficult, and I can only imagine in my mind how difficult it'd be, but I'd love you to answer this, right? How difficult is it for you to build programs which are, which are essentially homogeneous and relevant across this set, right? Irrespective of where they come from, what their lineage is, what business they stand, right? I mean, what's the art and science of having a balanced program, right? Which helps them deliver better or learn better and eventually get a good output.
That's a question we get very regularly. How can one system work for everyone? It's right. Not one fit for all, right? Which is very true. But right. What we teach in this program is a management system. Mm-hmm. We are teaching a business management system. As right. I told you, business has got 7 functions, correct? Mm-hmm. Sales, marketing, operations, account, 7 functions are there. Now, The question is, as long as if you have teams to work individually mm-hmm. and the teams can take decision on its own, if you're able mm-hmm. to manage them, and if you're able to create new products for future, thinking future develop, things can work, as simple as that. So that's the structure we have. We are a management system. We are not a functional business where I can't come and tell you what product to do, whether your product is good or not, correct? Right. So the whole problem is, I always tell this, what is business? Let's define business for a layman.
Right.
Business is a product or service you use to solve a customer's need.
Right.
Simple definition, correct? Mm-hmm. Product or service to solve a customer's need. If you're solving a customer's need, should the customer come to you or you should go to the customer?
Right.
That's the next question. Predominantly in the market, thousands of people are fighting for the same customer.
Right.
Correct? Now, what we teach in our program is, what if we show you a system where mm-hmm. you don't go to the customer, you are in the market as the perceived leader in that product and the customer comes to you. Now what happens? That's what we teach in terms of marketing, where we have 32 different magnetic marketing strategies we teach. Mm-hmm. Out of 32, for any business owner, 5 to 6 will work. Right. If they just do the 5 to 6, they are perceived as the market leader in the product or service and the customer comes to them. This mm-hmm. is what we teach. So it's a little different way of seeing it. What we do is something which the market has no clue about. Okay, let's go back to how people normally start business. Mm-hmm. They spend a lot of time in doing their logo. They spend a lot of time in their product and service. They really do that. They open shop and expect people to come.
Right.
That's the template people do, right?
Right.
Now, you might have the best product. Mm-hmm. I have a mentor who told me this. Best known will any day beat best. Think about that.
Right.
Best known will any day beat best. You might be the best. If the world doesn't know you, it won't work. So best known is very critical. So we kind of teach people what they mm-hmm. need to do.
Right.
And if they get that skill and apply mm-hmm. what is relevant for their business,
right.
that's when the change happens. And we have a methodology. Like we've been doing this from 2016, working with Rajiv. We have a case study of more than, I think last count, we had more than 12,000 people who come to a business-based program mm-hmm. in the last 3 years alone. Mm-hmm. These are people. Right now, I have a business-based program happening this weekend. We have more than 800 people coming for the program from across the India and across the world. Right. Thanks to technology, we're able to leverage and take it to every business owner's home. And mm-hmm. This program we do once a month. Mm-hmm. This year alone, our target is to reach around 12,000 people through the business-based program.
Interesting.
Next year, our target is 30,000 because the numbers are getting more. Thanks to technology, one of the things we are doing, rightly you asked us, India predominantly is rural. Mm-hmm. Predominantly is rural. Right. Tier 2, Tier 3 is the major market. And one of the problems is all our programs are in English. Mm-hmm. So now, if a guy is Hindi, he can't even understand a program.
Right.
Thanks to technology, next 2 months from now, we are going to do something where a simultaneous interpretation is going to happen. People mm-hmm. can see Rajiv in the screen, but they will listen in Hindi. And I can do 10 languages at the same time. That's the technology we're looking at. So just to solve the same problem you're saying, I don't want language to be a barrier where you don't get this information. That's what we're looking at. And ideally said, we don't go behind big corporations. 1,000 crore and above are not a target market. Right. Our target market is anybody from a 1 crore to a 500 crore. That's my target market. where you're basically MSME, the number which you told me, that's a major target market. And I feel with what we're doing, it's only growing. And apart from this, I also believe personal development also is important. Right. Only this won't work, correct?
Right.
End of the day, a lot of people say time is the most important commodity in a day. I don't think so. Focus in the time is the most important commodity. All of us have 24 hours, right? What should you focus on?
Correct. Right.
So that's where personal development comes in. It's the discipline. The problem with the entrepreneur, biggest problem, there's nobody to answerable. You can do it today, you can do it tomorrow. That's the problem.
You know,
that discipline. Discipline doesn't come. Yeah, go ahead.
You know, as you're saying what you're saying, right? I mean, there are like, you know, many, many questions that are coming to my mind, right? And it's just a very, very interesting discussion, right? Because I think, you're positioned in a very, you know, very uniquely, right? You have a vantage point, right? Where you're actually talking to a lot of these guys, right? You know, this is a question which is not part of the list of questions that I had, right? But it just sort of occurred to me in the process when you're saying what you're saying, right? I want to really understand what are some of the key challenges, right, of these people. Of course, I have a thesis around it. Many other people like me will have a, you know, larger understanding of what the gap areas and stuff like that. But, you know, that's an assumption, right? What you are possibly experiencing and sitting on is very real interaction, right? People challenges that, you know, many, many of these entrepreneurs are facing in their day-to-day lives, right? You know, we could possibly in an intellectual level rubbish it, right? But, you know, for people, you know, and, you know, coming from a tier two, tier three city, right? It's just so much more complicated, right? For them to understand these things. Exposure plays a huge, you know, a massive role in for them to get to that point and understanding basic concepts and stuff like that, right? I would love to understand what are some of these challenges, right? Something that, you know, we're not necessarily, say, part of our list of, you know, when we look at a distance, right? These are some very real issues. What are some of those issues that have actually stumped you saying that, you know, is this even an issue, right? tell me a little more about that.
I'll tell you the biggest challenge for if you actually ask a small and medium business owner, if you really ask, I think technology has disrupted everything. Let's face facts. COVID has disrupted everything.
Right.
This is a fact which you have to live in. But is that the end of the road? I don't think so. Right. It is just a way for you to start new. I truly believe COVID has helped people to really rework on everything. Health, wealth, relationship. It's like a reset button COVID did for us.
Right.
If you take it like that, you can do a fresh start and actually come out better after COVID. That's my understanding. And all the people who have gone through personal development through our trainings, I've actually said COVID is the best blessing. You take me. I used to do 150 plus seminars in 2019. COVID, I became zero. I've never done an online webinar. Never. But we learned very fast. We pivoted. And I'm every day today morning, I say COVID, I namah and start my day. You know why?
Right.
If not for COVID, I would have never gone online. Because of COVID, last month I had 75,000 customers coming into my platform.
Right.
With no way in a physical program that would have happened. Now to answer your question. The biggest challenge, most people think money, capital is the challenge. It's not true. Mm-hmm. It's not a true. Most people's business models are leaky buckets. Meaning, they thought that is the right way to do. Thanks to technical things of desperation, they're doing the same thing. Sometimes when you actually do the numbers with small and medium business owners, if they actually do more revenue, they'll actually lose more money.
Right.
What do I mean by that? Their payment cycles are very low. Let's say they get only payments once in 90 days.
Right.
If that payment delays by another 3 months, they lose their margins already. Another 3 months, they're already losing money. But they don't see it. For them, this is accumulating more businesses.
Interesting.
I'm just giving you. The biggest problem is human resources.
Mm-hmm.
They're not able to hold and retain good talent. Hiring is a big problem. If they have good people, they'll even go. So now that's where the culture comes into play. What is the culture you're setting in your organization?
Right.
So all these things. So I truly believe models have to evolve. Marketing is a big problem. People don't understand marketing in this country, and which is something very key no matter who you are.
Right.
And when say market people, then suddenly think digital marketing, let's jump into digital marketing.
Right.
Not even knowing. So it doesn't work. You need to find where your audience is.
Right.
Do content-based relative where people value you.
Right.
And then they come to you. So it's a different process. It's not selling directly.
Right.
See, a lot of times when you go to LinkedIn, straight away people will add you and they'll sell something. Somebody sells like that, what happens? Correct? Somebody calls you and sells something, what do you feel? You don't want to do it, right?
Right.
So all these old age things don't work.
Mm-hmm.
People need email marketing, doesn't work. Correct?
Right.
So the new age is you need to identify a customer, give value, where the customer perceives you're the expert. He will come to you when he remembers that I need this. That's the game. If you don't do that journey, you're going to get burned out in this market because the big players will throw money and kill you.
Correct? Right.
Where's your differentiator? No matter who you are. So it's a new age. You need to adapt to that. Can this be done? Yes. It's all about learning. I always say the only skill you need is LLL. What is LLL? Be a lifelong learner. As long as you're open to that, the world is an opportunity.
Right.
Everything is an opportunity as long as you're willing to learn, because every skill is taught, every technique is taught, and it's very easily available thanks to internet. As long as you have LLL, you're sorted.
I think what you're really kind of alluding to is mindset, right? I think if you have the right mindset, I think no, there's no problem, right? I think everything is an opportunity, and I think you'll start to look at it differently. And I think that really solves a very large problem, right? I think mindset is a huge issue. I think especially in a country like India, right? I mean, I think we continue to sort of battle, you know, baggages, right? And I think that is a time taking process, right? We're not necessarily ready to kind of give up those weights, right? And I think that really stops us from going faster, right? But I'm kind of intrigued, right? And I want to ask you this, right? Which has been the top performing region for you, right? I mean, where do you see maximum participation coming from? Is it up north? Is it down south? Is it east? Is it west? Right? What's the mix?
Okay, the majority customers for me is from Mumbai and around Mumbai. That's my number one market. It's always been like that.
Right.
Maybe lots of business owners are there, the density is there, but Mumbai has been my number one market when I used to do physical programs. I'm going to give you data before 2019. Number one was Mumbai, second was Delhi, followed by Bangalore, then Chennai, Hyderabad. That's used to be the cycle.
Right.
So my major was north. Major.
Right.
Mumbai used to give me almost 40% of my revenue.
Right.
When we used to do. After COVID, interesting. My training programs, I have people coming from 100 cities and towns across the world.
Interesting.
At least 60 to 70 from tier 2, tier 3.
Right.
So the major market is like Aurangabad. I have so many customers from Aurangabad. You ask me, I don't even know where it's in the map of India.
Right.
So now it's opened up thanks to technology. That's where I feel the growth is. So when we went online, we rewrote our numbers. We said, we want to take this education to every household in the country.
Right.
Because I truly believe all people need is a chance.
Right.
No matter who you are, if you have a mobile phone, you can get access to the education. Mm-hmm. And all the programs we do is either free or 99 rupees,
right,
which anybody can pay. That's all we do. Because we are a platform, you get connected from there, and you like a trainer, you can follow him. That's all we do.
Very interesting. Very interesting.
That's the model we do.
It's amazing to hear of Aurangabad, right? I mean, I've been born and brought up in a tier 2 city, and I know the kind of aspiration that tier 2 has is absolutely phenomenal. In fact, even tier 3 for that happens, right? And I think given the right foundation, given the right thinking framework, I think these are exceptional. You can have exceptional stories that could come out of this. And I think COVID has been a great leveler in that sense, right? Because I think now what's say good for you and possible for you sitting in Bangalore or a Delhi or a Bombay, right, is equally good and possible for I think anybody sitting in a tier 2 city, right? And I think this could just become a phenomenal turning point at that level, right? I think the only possible gap continues to be I think language preferences, right? I think which now are kind of you've kind of alluded to it, right? I think there are many technologies that have come in, right, which is kind of solving this problem, right? I think it's going to be an interesting play, right? I think this is going to be a very interesting phase for India as a country, right? For the aspiration that we've always had, unfortunately, because of physical inefficiencies and physical models that were built, people couldn't necessarily sort of go out and consume anything. But I think now is a very different time. Surendran, I want to talk a little about the business, right? Now, the way I look at SuccessGyan, right, is that you're the house, right? You're not the player, right? What are the key matrices, for you as a business, right? What is it that you continue to evaluate yourself on, right? And when I say, when I kind of mention or compare you with, say, a house and not the player, is because you have that possibility of bringing in many such players, right? So for example, Rajiv is something that you mentioned of. There are many international players that, speakers that you've mentioned of. You always have a possibility of mixing and matching, right? So what are the key matrices that you look at? How does that empanelment of new speakers happen, right? What's the assessment framework there? Tell me a little bit more about those aspects and nuances in the business.
Thank you, Ashur. Brilliant question. 2012, when we started, first program was Brian Tracy.
Right.
From 2012 to 2016, we had bought Robert Kiyosaki, Les Brown, John Gray, Dr. John, you name it.
Right.
55
right.
plus thought leaders to India. Most of them came to India for the very first time through SuccessGyan.
Right.
And people always used to ask this question, why only international trainers? Don't we have talent in India? That was the predominant question.
Right.
So I always used to say that the Indian I work with should be truly world-class.
Right.
I wait till that. So 2016 is when we started working with Rajiv Talreja.
Right.
And he's the first Indian we started working. Rajiv Talreja was a student in a SuccessGyan seminar from 2013. So I know him as a student and I knew he was very good. We built a relationship and I felt he has a product which can solve MSME, the market you said. That's how we started working. Currently, from the 5,000 plus trainers who want to work with SuccessGyan, Right. We are working currently with 9 Indian trainers. That's all. Mm-hmm. These are 9 Indian trainers who've been shortlisted from 5,000 plus who want to work with us. Mm-hmm. Because everybody knows Satsangya is the biggest platform. Once they come in, they're going to get thousands of customers. So everybody wants to work with us.
Right.
But we have a very strong filtering process. Mm-hmm. For a simple reason, I want to know your mission. Why do you want to do this?
Right.
If it's only money, then you're not my person.
Right. Correct?
So for me, I really need to understand what is the problem you're solving. Are you really good at it? Do you have mm-hmm. a team to solve it when it scales? Do people get value at every end of your funnel? So for me, I have a very 30 big metrics to measure whether these guys are the right guys. And once we sign up, because we have floodgates opening and thousands of trainers are going to come to them. Mm-hmm. So we are positioned as a platform. As you rightly said, none of them are in my payroll. They are extremely good. That's why they are in my platform.
Right.
And once they are in our platform, they have an exclusive contract with us. They can't work anywhere else. And they're abided to do all the 12, 15 things we want them to do for a customer. So they're kept at such a high quality. So today in India, if you say SuccessGAN, they know it's quality.
Right.
If it's a SuccessGAN trainer, they're the best of the best. So that's how we curate our trainers. So we have a very strong filtering process.
Interesting.
Now, having said that, what is that we want to do in the future?
Right.
We really want to take this education to every household in the country. Mm-hmm. Can we do only with our 12 trainers or 15 trainers? I don't think so, because the needs of the country are very high. Mm-hmm. So we're actually setting an ecosystem for trainings, where we tell people, if you want to be a Rajiv Talreja or a Siddharth Rajshekar, who are the best right now in India, we'll tell you what to do, mm-hmm. what trainings to do, how to work on your skill set, everything. So we kind of set the ecosystem now. So that's why you can see hundreds of trainers mushrooming in India, mm-hmm. necessarily not with SuccessGAN as a brand name behind, but they're actually going creating the impact because we've set the ecosystem now. That's mission for us, because we truly believe first to 16th century, India was the number one economy. If you go by history, we were number one.
Right.
Then British came to a system, changed their education system, which we still follow.
Right.
I truly believe 5 years from now, India will be the training capital of the world.
Interesting.
Because we have so much talent. Just that we don't know how to package and sell. That's a problem.
And the
West is very good. They've actually taken content from us and repackaged and selling to us all these years. So that's the problem I'm solving. Where I'm telling my trainers and teachers, we will show you everything. We'll tell you how to package, how to sell, go create an impact, make the money, and let's make India the training capital of the world. That's
interesting. So when you say that, right? I mean, I have a bunch of questions on competition, right? And I'm sure you know what I'm going to come to, right? But I think before I do that, right? What I want to talk about is your relationship and engagement with your trainers, right? So you kind of mentioned off exclusivity, for example, right? But I'm finding it very very difficult in the sense that you're selling your courses at 99 rupees, for example, as a startup, right? And that becomes, say, your entry to your funnel and other such mechanics that you've put together. But what's your relationship with your trainers, right? Is SuccessGAN a slightly more institutionalized, glorified digital marketing agency for these trainers, which is, helping them get to their clients and customers? Or is there more to it? For example, Rajiv coming in and giving a seminar, right? It could be a 4-hour, 5-hour seminar, could be a 2-day, 3-day seminar, right? But the role of SuccessGAN becomes, much larger than that, where, you can kind of now engage with the business owners, where they can, continue to whatever they've kind of taken away from that, say the webinar, seminar, conference, right? Can now implement that and you become a part of that journey. What's the business model like, right? And I think in a way, this is a question which possibly talks of, what's the next 2 years like, right, for SuccessGAN, right? That's essentially, I would love to understand, those aspects.
Okay, Ashu, the model is very simple. We are a platform, okay?
Right.
Which means I don't have a trainer in my payroll. I get the best of the best trainers for my customers. So that's the model. Now, when a customer comes to me, I do not want to sell anything. I want him to come and experience what it is.
Right.
If he likes, he's going to buy from the trainer directly in the future.
Right.
That's how we are pushing now. So all my entries, I run all these summits. Like we just did something called a Super Growth Summit. Where we had 14,697 people who came for a one-day program, completely free of cost. Mm-hmm. There were 14 trainers, each spoke for 21 minutes, all free. And from there, we gave the 4-hour, 3 hours masterclass free.
Mm-hmm.
So people come to a summit like this, they experience Rajiv for 21 minutes,
mm-hmm.
then they get a free program, which is 4 hours of Rajiv, if they really like it. Then they buy a business-based program for 999. That's where the revenue. So two layers of free, when they really know this is what they want, they buy. So this is how we do it, and we hold it. So what do you mean by that? The 999 is still collected by us.
Right.
Why? Because we want to be accountable to all our customers.
interesting.
And that's the reason where all trainers know what they have to deliver. At every level, we have Success Gyan watching.
Right.
Because they have to deliver the value. So that's how the model we have created.
Right.
Now, if a customer really likes Rajiv after 3 days, if he wants to buy a coaching, there's a higher product Rajiv and his coaches give. So that's right. how the model is evolved. So people come into a free program. Mm-hmm. It's like a trailer. From a trailer, the main 2-day, 3-day program, main 4 hours is again like a bigger trailer of understanding what they want. They still like, then they buy the 3-day program, which is the main picture.
Mm-hmm.
That's the analogy I want to give. From there, they continue if they want to continue with the trainer. So that's the analogy.
You know, I would have rather not asked you this question, but you know, I mean, given that we're talking about your model, right? And given, I mean, you essentially operate in the larger framework, say EdTech, right? If I'm to classify you from a distance, I would classify this as an EdTech, right? Now, so I think EdTech, you know, I think any of the companies that you talk of, right? I think they're under tremendous amount of pressure when it comes to conversions, right? And I think the industry standard right now is 1.5% conversion, right? What are the kind of conversions that you see, right? Because, you know, India, at least up north, right? And I operate out of the North India market. I've been here for a long time. I mean, you know, this is an analogy I give to many, many people, right? That, you know, unless you make, for example, you know, freeways, you know, unless you make it mandatory for people to buy those, you know, fast tags, right? And it becomes, they are challenged at least 3x, 4x, people will not buy it, right? It's because we have a tendency to continue to push and delay, right? And like I said, something that I'd asked right at the outset, right? I mean, we are in denial, right? We think it's going to happen, right? And, you know, and there are, you know, forces that are going to come in and they're going to intervene and, you know, and it's going to get perfect, right? How long is the conversion process? How difficult is the conversion process, right? Given that you're dealing with a mindset shift, I mean, that's essentially what you're doing. What is, what are the numbers like there?
Awesome question, Ashu. I just want to tell you that I own 100% of the company. We have zero liability. We're not funded by anybody. First.
Okay. Right.
So I'm still an old school business wala, which means for me, a business needs to run on its own. It needs to be profitable for it to scale.
Right.
I don't believe that tomorrow, 5 years from now, my customer would buy this so that I'll take money from him. I don't believe in that model. I'm still old school. So we're not building it for a valuation game. So let me rephrase it better.
Right.
If you want to build it for valuation, I can really do it well. This year we're doing 100 crores.
Right.
Okay. So it's a very powerful model. Now to answer your question. See, the model we evolved is most people out there in the market, they burn for customer acquisition, correct? They spend a lot of money for customer acquisition.
Right.
And that's what they do. Now, do we spend for customer acquisition? Yes. But we have a model which supports that, which means you will see my ad for a free event.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Whatever we spend on Facebook, whatever we spend from that. I told you 14,697 people came for a summit we did, which a few days before. That was 9:30 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. It was seven hours. From there, around 12 trainers had offered their free programs.
Mm-hmm.
So 2,000 to 2,500 people registered to those programs.
Right.
Okay. From there, we normally have a 10% conversion, which buys to the next one.
Mm-hmm.
So what we have done is, instead of spending too much money to acquire a customer to buy a $999 product, I spend a little money and tell them to come and experience something free.
Mm-hmm.
If the guy sees value, he's going to continue with me. That's the game. So for me, I give value. And if he likes it, he's going to continue because what we do, the market doesn't do at all the way we do it also.
Right.
So that's where that comes in. And we have so many, for me, what worked? All my customers, happy customers are raving fans.
Right.
Which means they go talk about it because you will never see something like this in the market. You will never see it. There's so much heart into it because we truly believe that this education can change somebody's life. We put a lot of heart into it, the whole ecosystem. So they know it. So all these people become raving fans of us.
Right.
These summits are actually filled by our customers.
Mm-hmm.
There's no affiliate, there's no revenue model, nothing. Because they truly believe we're also doing the change. One of the things we just started doing was, we wanted this lifelong learning as a habit.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's the only way to be successful in today's world.
Right.
Whatever you know today is obsolete tomorrow. So you need to update yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So we started something called 8 p.m. learning hour.
Right.
Saying that in this country, at 8 p.m., don't see a news channel. Don't see a stupid serial which is not going to make a difference in life. Can you log into my platform and learn something?
Right.
That's the idea. And we have started this from August 15 this year.
Interesting.
In a social audio app called Clubhouse. I'm sure you're familiar with Clubhouse. It's a social audio app which has just come in. At every day at 8 p.m., I have a world-class trainer coming and doing a one-hour session completely free where you can interact and ask questions to them.
Right.
8 p.m. learning hour. That's the shift we're doing at a grassroots level. So ours is more mission, where we really want people to get started in lifelong learning. Because the minute they get started, they understand that the best investment they have to do is on themselves. That's it. Once they get that formula, there's no looking back. Everything can be fixed. Because I truly believe it's not our life. What do I mean by that? People sometimes say, if you go behind money, you have to lose your health and relationship.
Right.
Because you have to go behind money. I don't believe that. You can actually become super successful, make lots of money, have very good health, have great relationships, have great spirituality, travel. Right. All seven areas you can holistically grow. It is possible. Just that you don't know how to do it. We are going to teach you that. That's our goal. Because only going behind money doesn't work. That's my take. Because there's no point losing relationship making money, right? We know so many entrepreneurs who really live their life off. They make it money, but they have a bad relationship at home. What's the point? So holistic is what we go at behind. So the model is basically we're a platform. We have these trainers who work exclusively with us. We get customers at extremely zero cost or 99 rupees cost. They experience what we do. If they see value, they continue. And they see value because the numbers work.
Very interesting. You know, that's a good one, right? And thank you for taking us through that journey, right? And I think I understand where you're coming from. I think that experiential part is very, very important in this because, you know, there's nothing definitive. I mean, each business is different. I think each entrepreneur's journey is different, right? And I think unless you offer that experiential aspect, right? Unless you give them that space to come in and engage, right? It will not. And I think this will possibly, I think the takeaway from this conversation, which you're possibly doing, right? The early 99 rupee events and free events that you're doing, right? Is that they at least go back and think, you know, what the problems are, right? Which is in a certain way, a reality check, right? Which helps them possibly value what you're offering much better. And I think that's a great insight. And I think if, and that possibly many brands can actually do that, right? Create an experiential engagement, create an experiential relationship that just works beautifully. Sundar, we're towards the end of the conversation, right? And I can't let go without talking of competition, right? And you know what I mean, right? There's a lot of that which is happening. There are affiliates that are coming in. There are halls that are filled with, you know, people who are, you know, become business consultants, right? There's a lot of that which is happening. What do you make out of that, right? I find it extremely disturbing, right? And that is largely because you know, it's very difficult. What a founder and entrepreneur is going through, right? You can't have a consultant coming in and solving it for you, right? You can't do it through just doing certain videos, right? Which are half-baked, right? Where you're just choosing to put out information in certain form and way, right? You're packaging in a certain form and way. This is something which needs to be a little more scientific, right? This is something which needs to be a little more absolute. This is something which has to be very definitive, right? It has to be very measurable, right? I think under the compulsion of creating a business model, and I think you know what I'm talking about, right? I think there are other players who are also coming in, right? Who are kind of now looking at this as a cross-sell opportunity, where they're saying, you know, take this course, take that course, right? 99 rupees, whatever, right? And we're seeing a lot of those campaigns, right? What do you make out of this, right? My sense is, like I said, right? To me, it's a lot very disturbing because a lot of this is going to land up setting a very, very negative impression in the minds of people, right? Which essentially means that they will fear coming in and consuming right help, right? What's your sense of this?
Okay, thank you, Ashu. Very, very important question, especially when COVID happened, no? Suddenly, you open your newsfeed in Facebook, you'll only see ads of trainers.
Right.
See, the problem is anybody can call themselves a trainer.
Right.
There's no entry barrier, correct?
Right.
There's no course, there's no coaching, nothing. You can just call yourself a trainer. That's the problem. But also having said that, if you open right now your newsfeed, all these trainers have died because if you don't give value, the market will kill you.
Right.
Simple. It's online world. You can't bullshit your way through, correct? You can tell whatever you want in your ad, but if you don't give value, they're going to talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
So as simple as that. It's a value game.
Right.
And all I tell people, there are only two promises. Okay. Mm-hmm. All entrepreneurs, all trainers, I tell them, just two promises. What is, number one, mm-hmm. are you giving more value than the money you collect?
Right.
If you don't do that, you're done.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Second, are you honoring all your promises?
Right.
That's it. If you can do these two things, you're sorted.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, just do these two things, you're sorted.
Right.
For that only, one of the reasons is actually we're running a reality show called Super Speaker.
Uh-huh.
Okay, what is the reality show? It's a hunt to find the next best motivational speaker in the country.
Right.
We have 40,185 people who applied for it.
Okay? Right.
It's still going on. We have qualified them to round two, where 250 people are there. The intention is to showcase to trainers and coaches what it takes to be truly world-class.
Mm-hmm.
Because as you rightly said, for one good trainer, we have 20 quacks who are half paid trying to sell, because you can, anybody can run a Facebook ad, right? Anybody can run Instagram ad. So that's the problem. So for me, I feel it's my primary responsibility to keep the ecosystem clean. As you rightly said, we do not want people to feel training is bad. Because I paid 1,000 rupees, this guy never gave value. I don't want that to happen. Right. So we're actually doing this from a backbone, saying, let's clean the industry. Tell people what is the right way to do it. Because if you don't do the right way, you can't really become world class. As simple as that. So that's one of the responsibilities for us. Though it's not our business model, we feel it's our responsibility to do it for the goodness of the market also. In fact, we educate our customers. We tell them what you need to look before you go buy. Don't go behind an ad.
Right.
Go research the guy. Don't go even over behind testimonials. What is testimony? That product was good. No. Find success stories.
Right.
With what they teach worked.
Mm-hmm.
Very key metric, right? If it worked, then go behind it. So we tell, we educate our audience saying these are 10 things you need to look before going by something. So I feel it's a prime responsibility. In terms of competition, I have nobody in India who does at the scale what we do. There's nobody there. There's nobody. It's very difficult to do also because we've been doing it for 2012. We have a huge learning curve. We know what people want, the way it needs to be given for people to consume it, and the way it needs to be taught for them to implement it. It's too many parameters here.
And I think you're not.
They won't get it.
And I think you're not trying to make a hero for yourself, right? Which is very important in the entire scheme of things, right? Sridharan, a very important question, and my last question, right, is, you know, COVID has been a very difficult situation for each one of us, right, at a personal level and a professional level. And this is, again, a constant across, I think, each of my conversations, right? It's, you know what it's done, right? And I'm talking purely on the business context of COVID, right? And on the consumer side of it, basically the business and consumer is essentially what I'm kind of referring to in this particular question, right? Is that the consumer, we operated a very different ecosystem, like you said, right? I mean, in a pre-2020 environment, you were doing a lot of physical, sessions, right? Where you only touch with X number of people, right? But right now you're doing 10X, right? Because of the beauty of digital and your ability to go out and communicate, right, in a digital format. What has essentially happened is that the consumer has actually moved largely on, right? And that's not something which is a tier A phenomenon. It's across the board, right? It's across the country, right? So the arbitrage that existed between, say, tier A and tier 2 markets, right, is kind of reduced to essentially negligible, right? There could be exposure is kind of reduced, I mean, improved, right, across all of these markets. Aspiration is improved, right? I mean, we can continue to sort of talk of the financial challenges that continue to exist, but I think that's a discussion for a different time, right? My sense is, for the business, it's going to become very, very different, right? Their expectation for the consumer is going to become very different. That's number one. Number two, it's a very transparent ecosystem, right? You cannot deliver bad or incomplete solution or value. And the consumer will not, nobody else will not know about it, right? Now, it's a, like I said, very transparent environment that you're getting, right? Consumer preferences are going to be, will start to look very different, right? So, typically for a product that will have like 3, 4, 5, 6 years of life, right? Will essentially now have a 15, 17 month life, right? Which is substantially reduced. We're in a very, very complicated ecosystem, right? What do you make out of a situation like this, especially for SMEs, MSMEs, the ones that you deal with, right? Because they're essentially coming from a zone where they've not prioritized many, many things. There's a huge mindset challenge that they are with. There's a baggage that is there. And here the consumer is already moved, right? Their longevity, their relevance might just be much smaller than what they anticipate, right? There could be different kind of pressures. What do you make out of the complexity of this?
Okay, Ashu, brilliant question. First to answer, let's understand the fact the world has changed. It's not going to go back to how it was before. Let's understand the truth fact, okay?
Right.
That's something everybody has to bite that pill.
Mm-hmm.
If you're saying that COVID will come down, it'll go back to normal, it'll go back, it's done. COVID has changed everybody. As you rightly said, the behavioral pattern has changed. People have got used to online now. People have got used to service to a crazy level. People have got used to crazy offers. So that's the truth. That's the reality. And that's the world we are living in.
Right.
If businesses don't upgrade themselves to compete in an environment like that, they're going to perish.
Right.
As simple as that. But can it be done? Yes, it can be done. Mm-hmm. You clearly need to understand who's your core audience and what is that one value which only you can give, which nobody can give. And how you can make them understand that only you're giving, then work it out. So actually, I truly believe it's not a price game also.
Mm-hmm.
It's more a value game.
Right.
See, there's a dosa in a five-star hotel that charges 500 rupees. There's a dosa at 5 rupees in a street corner. It's the same dosa, correct? How is he able to charge 500? That's the question. Same thing. So it's not the price point. It's a value game. It's a positioning game. It's a learning game. Have you really started learning to understand how your consumers change and work towards it?
Mm-hmm.
But the truth is, COVID has disrupted it. Technology has disrupted it. This has come to stay. This is what the future is going to be. You need to really reevaluate every little thing you're doing now. If you're a small and medium business owner, you have to really think through all that I'm doing, is it relevant in the current world? If not, what should I do to make it relevant, to compete and be there? And what are the skills I need to do? What are the marketing I need to learn? Everything you have to go learn and start doing. Plus, you also need to think futuristic, because this is for right now. Right. What will happen 1 year from 2 years? You need a plan. See, as simple as that. One of my mentors taught me this, correct? Mm-hmm. If you do not foresee what might happen and be ready right now, you're done. It's not only solving a problem right now. Okay, you need to actually see what might happen in the future and look at what need to be learned to be ready. If you're not future ready, you're done. That's the word. If you really want to be relevant in current terms, you have to be future ready. And if you start working towards it, it's a learnable skill issue. It can be done. But having said that, some businesses are redundant. You have to face the fact that it's done. It's no more viable in a current environment. And the biggest problem the business owner says is, I don't know to do anything else. What will I do?
Right.
If you ask him, tell him, no, this doesn't work. He says, I don't know to do anything. What will I do? But I always tell people, rather close it and cut your losses. You are an entrepreneur who created. You have the same brain to create something new. Be ready for it. That's a better direction than to try to pull something which is not working anymore. So it's a little shift. As you rightly said, it's a mindset shift. It's a learning shift, but it can be done.
Right.
Entrepreneur, I truly believe 1.4 billion people in this country, Ashu, correct? As you rightly said, middle class, which is consuming left, right, center. Tier 2, tier 3, the disparity has changed. People are really, in fact, people buy much more easy in a tier 2, tier 3. It's easy to convince them than a tier 1. So people are consuming. It's not that people are not consuming. Just that the way they're consuming has changed.
Right.
The way they see the product and services change, the perceived has changed. So we just need to adapt to them rather than expect them. If you adapt, I think it will work. It's an AQ challenge, adaptability quotient challenge.
Thank you so much for summing it up so beautifully, right? And I think, you know, when you were actually saying what you were, you know, typically what happens, and I think it happens in each one of our lives, right? Is, you know, there are those 20 people that you want to help, right? You know, you want to constantly sort of talk sense with. Unfortunately, you know, you're not able to cut it through, right? And you continue to sort of, you know, it's an argument, right? By the end of it, right? And I think this just seems to be a perfect, play, right? For I think you know, us, and I'm sure many others, to sort of channelize those people we want to help, right? In that direction, right? Because I think this is something which could, in a very neutral environment, could essentially help them understand what they're going to be up against, right? And the complexity of the changed ecosystem, right? Surendran, thank you so much for taking the time out. I loved each bit of this conversation, right? You know, I think what you're doing, of course, you know, while of course you're on a mission of educating and, you know, empowering and, you know, changing the lives of a lot of these SMEs, MSMEs, I think a very significant part and a significant role that you're playing is essentially to ensure that they're happy by the end of it, right? And many, many people who are, you know, within their families, you know, associated with them as employees, stakeholders, right, are happy at large, because there's a responsibility that is going to come into their behaviors, right? And I think that's the narrative that I would want to, you know, close this conversation with, right? And I think that's essentially what you're doing, right? While you've not necessarily spoken of it, but I think that's the kind of impact that you're creating. And I hope and I wish all the very best to you. We hope, you know, you get many such trainers, right? Many such trainers identified. People start seriously engaging with such professionals, right? Are able to understand and prioritize their business goals better and build good value for themselves. And like I said, you know, stakeholders around them. Thank you so much. It was a pleasure to have you with us.
Thank you, Ashu. I really love this conversation. All I want to say is, if you have anybody watching this, just be a LLL, lifelong learner. That's the one skill you need to do. Rest all will be taken care. Thank you, Ashu, for the platform. I really, really enjoyed this conversation.
Thank you. Beautiful.